Sister Sandra, happy birthday. And we know we are going to have a luncheon. But we've got a few more things we want to work through first. Sandra Lee Harriman Talbot, this is your life. Sandra Lee Harriman was born Fort Campbell, Kentucky, to Sterling Sylvester Harriman and Naomi Ruth Williams Harriman, Monday, September 20th, 1954. And I know that you had several siblings. I know from having a big family that there was never a dull moment, hardly ever a quiet moment, but very interesting times, wonderful times.
The Secret Service had 7 special agents. 001, David Harriman, sends his love. 002, Joseph Miles Harriman, sends his love. 003 is thee. 004 looks down, sends her love. 005 and 6, they're just confused. But 007 gets to share in his heart the special love of a wonderful sister.
You're supposed to guess who. Come and give her a hug. So we have a few other surprises today.
I knew all along. So Sister Campbell called me and asked me if I would help her out with a special something for you that she was going to try to do, and as you can see, it doesn't take much for her to get something together. And I said, well, of course, you know, that would be there. But I told Sister Sandra, literally Sister Sandra, that I wasn't going to be able to be here, and then it ended up that I was able to be here, and we knew that there was going to be a tea. She was told there was going to be a tea, and I said, well, I'm not going to go to a tea with a bunch of women, and, oh, you can be my guest. It's like going to a baby shower. I'm not going to the tea. So that way she wouldn't think that I was going to get to be here as well. But my earliest memories of Sandra, thank you. I am quite a bit younger than Sandra. Really, I'm nearly 60 as well. But my earliest memories of Sandra, and this will be a wonderfully difficult time, was a sweet spirit that she shared. Even though I heard stories that she locked brothers and sisters in closets when she was left to babysit because they wouldn't do what she wanted. These are all stories because I'm really quite a bit younger than she is as well. And heard stories that she would be found walking outside the house in the middle of the night, sleepwalking. But she and I shared a special connection with the Holy Spirit. And when she left for college, I was left alone, and even though there were many other siblings there, she and I would write letters to one another, and those letters are in my heart.
ministry and choir leader. As you can see, she was very involved in the work of the church. Not only was she a hard and faithful worker in the church, she always encouraged to others with her smile and warmth personality. She was greatly loved and respected by my wife and I and the entire church. I know we could not have been as successful in our ministry without her. Thank you, Sister Sandra. We love and appreciate you very much, Brother Carl Farnell.
Happy birthday, Sandra. I just wanted to let you know I was thinking about you and wishing that I was there for the celebration. I know you guys are having a lot of fun and having a lot of good food. Just thinking of the past memories that we have together and how God's brought and directed our paths all through the years. Thinking of the impact that you had on me as a person. Just the anointing that's always flowed from you with the singing and the choir that you led into flow, the deaf ministry, just every area of your life, you've always been a blessing to others. And I just want to thank God for you. I want you to know that I wish you well the next year to come. I pray that God will give you great abundance in every area of your life. And I hope to come see you soon. Love you. Have a great, great birthday.
Hey, Sandra. It's me, Judy. I wanted to be here with you today to celebrate your day. And I wanted you to know how much you encouraged me or influenced me in my life. All that you taught me, it took a deep root way down inside me, and it never left me. And I want to promise you that your influence will continue forever and ever and ever. And I thank you, and I love you, and I want you to excuse my hair care. Love you, girl. Bye-bye.
On August 6, 1983, she married Ronald E. Talbot. We have three lovely children, Matthew Allen, Brittany Christine, and Alicia Chantel. And from there, we have four grandchildren, and Lydia Ruth, Liam Marcus, Clara Caitlin, Naomi, Elizabeth, and yes, the fifth one's on the way. A tribute to Sandra, and I should ask you if you can guess this, but it's just a dream, my dear Sandra. It is hard to believe we were once young enough to think that 50, 60 was old. Not that I'm calling you old by any means. First, I want to say, Ron was a Bubba that I knew would get married, but I was afraid would get someone less deserving of him. He never brought girls around the house, so I never knew if he was seeing anyone or not, which was a good thing. I never had any sisters, so I always dreamed that my brothers would marry some girl and we would be best friends, sisters like, well. Then he began to talk about a young lady down in Tupelo, Mississippi, and how she signed at their church and could sing. He was never overexcited when he spoke of her. However, he had a certain glimmer in his eyes I wasn't sure if I liked it. It seemed he brought her home from one of his many trips to Mississippi to meet us all. That was a shock, because, like I said, he was not one to bring girls to the house. Well, from the first sight, hug, she was everything I would hope for my brother. She loved God with all her heart, and she glowed. She had the heart of Jesus, and it showed from the inside out. She had the voice of an angel. I had never heard anyone sing like that except at camp meeting. I knew by the first meeting that there was something about her, something very, very special. And indeed, there was something very, very special about her. They were married in August after I had moved to Denver, Colorado. Sandra, she has the heart of God. She has been a constant in our life. Ron's helpmate, right hand neck that turns the head, LOL. She has been there for mom and dad that has made me jealous at times. She has filled the gaps as a daughter when it should have been me. But I'm so thankful she is there. She is everything I hope to be for by the time I am 60. She is kind, soft words. She loves deeply. She is constant. She is a giver. She is faithful. I could go on and on and on. But on this special day, Sandra, I want to thank you for all that you have done for our family. Thank you for making my Bubba so happy. Thank you for being there for mom and dad and stepping in the gap. Thank you for loving my mom and dad. Thank you for giving of your time and yourself. Thank you for being a praying woman. Thank you for the many cards of concern and support while I have been going through the walk and journey of cancer. That meant everything. Mike Sr. would say, honey, you have a card in the mail. Looks like from Sandra, at least twice a week. It may have taken a day or two to open it because I was so sick. But it was there. And there was something very comforting about that card looking at me. I pray God gives you the best birthday any person could deserve this year, Sandra. I love you. Our family loves you. You mean the world to us. I wish I could be there. Happy birthday to one of the most beautiful women I have known. Thank you for marrying my brother. Love, Cheryl.
You've got your children. Matthew, do you want to come and greet your mother? And Alicia, if you'll come up, wherever you are. And Brittany, get in line. At least say happy birthday. These are wonderful children. They've grown up in the church. I've been here since they've been here. Wonderful. And wonderful job, man.
Had to get my selfie in. So I've been thinking this last 24 hours what I'm going to say. And, you know, I haven't known her for that long, only all my life. There are some people in this room that have known her longer than I've been alive, though. But one thing I can say about my mom is that she is dedicated. She's dedicated to the school, dedicated to the church, dedicated to us, 3. No matter what we're going through, our ups, our downs, she's dedicated. She's the true definition of a mother. Loves you no matter how much you're getting on her nerves. There will always be one story stuck in my mind where I got on her last nerve. And I'm sure there are people in here who know how well I can get on people's nerves. And she raised her voice and screamed, "Matthew!" And she came at me. Ugh. Of course, I've always, since I was about 13, been bigger than her. And she just started swinging at me. And then she sent me to my room. I'll never forget that. Because even though I got on her last nerve, she still loves me anyway. And she puts up with me. And I love you, Mom. And I thank you for being a wonderful mother.
I'll just, you know, stay away from you. Over the last week, I've tried thinking of things to say about you. You've always been so sacrificing of your time for others that sometimes, you know, I sometimes felt like you cared for others more than you cared for me. But I know how wrong that was, because I know that I am your favorite and you love me the most. Just happy birthday, Mom, and I love you so much. No. I, like my sister, have been thinking and thinking and thinking of what I could say that would be special to my mom. But there's just been so many times that she's always been there. She's always been the person you go to if you need advice, you need a hug, you need just an encouraging pat on the shoulder. So I came across a song this morning that I threw together, and I'm going to dedicate it to you. Just forgive the mess ups. Thank you.
And when Brother Ron and Sister Sandra married, and she moved to Illinois, well, she has been with Creve Coeur Christian Academy at that time, in the time. We have some people here that know all about Creve Coeur Christian Academy. We're a part of it. And we're going to do a guessing game again, but first, we have the students, the very heart of now Christian Life Academy or Creve Coeur Christian Academy, whichever. First this.
Sister Sandra and Brother Ron have been like extended family. And in that period of time, you would expect to see the weak links of their life. You would expect to see the skeletons in the closet eventually have to fall out sometime, right? And I do have to say that there has been a constance or a firm foundation, a reliability, a complete, what's the word I'm looking for? Authenticity about her life. And I think that more than the tact, and more than just the funny, quippy things that she's able to say, I have to say the thing that has really wanted to make me aspire to something is to be who I am and not be fearful about letting people see who that is and live my life in a firm and constant fashion before God. And if I can live in that constant way before God, then there would never be any concern or controversy before mankind. I have seen a person that gives all they have to whatever it is. Simple special song, pulling together a Christmas play with 30 half-witted, unruly children, and at the end of all of that effort has something that looks good. I have seen the pressures of a simple schedule and how it is just the way it is. A person has responsibilities. What I'm talking about is having the responsibilities of getting her family up and ready, and then having to be the first person that makes it to school, and having to be on, and, you know, that correct face for people throughout the day, and then having to finish up the school day, think about supper and all of the essentials necessary for the family, be prepared for church, and at some point finally go to bed and start it all over again tomorrow. I guess my sensitivity to that right now is because that kind of feels like my life. And I'm so thankful that I have fantastic examples that have indicated that you can live such a hectic life and not lose God and not lose your sweetness with people and still have a passion and an enthusiasm for doing it because it matters. You knew I couldn't do this without bursting out into tears. You also had to know that I'm so thankful for technology that I can burst out in said tears and yet be in my comfortable cocoon at home. So, I know these moments don't come around a lot. Oh, and one last thing, though. I talked about teachable moments, funny stuff, constance, authenticity, but let me also just say a word about graciousness. I am so thankful for your graciousness. I know if I was there in person right now, you would just be, you know, shoving people out of the way so that you could come and, like, scoop me up and hug me until I can't breathe and say, oh, that was so precious, and I'm so thankful you were here, and all of those things you said from your heart, and I just have to say that thank you for being gracious. Thank you for not being the person that says, I told you so. I knew you were that person. And not make me feel all awkward about that. So that's the other precious, precious thing. All in all, I am so thankful for my life and for the influences that have been in my life. And I just have to say, happy birthday. Enjoy the next 60. God bless you.
Okay, now we're going to do the guessing game again, okay? All right. Next.
I have one word to say. Hakuna Matata. Brittany said she was her that she was your favorite child. I'm the favorite student. But she made everybody feel that way. Everybody was her favorite, always. And just like Kim said, I'm a mom now. I'm a wife. I have everything that you do every day. And she came to school every day and made you feel like you were the only person in the world, that you mattered so much to her, when really you matter so much to us. You created so much in all of us. And I thank you, because I know how much you gave. Now that I'm an adult, we didn't know that growing up, how much she gave, but we know that now.
I just have a song for you, and it goes something like this. I don't want to grow up, I'm a CLA kid. There's a million faces I can do and learn from them too. There's math and English and word building too. It's the greatest school there is. I don't want to grow up, Because Sister Sandra, if I did, I wouldn't be a CLA kid. CLA! Well, I've known Sister Sandra probably since kindergarten or maybe a little bit before, because my older sister and brother were at the school. But I have so many memories of school, but one of the special memories I have is of Sister Sandra scooting up next to me on the piano bench at the end of award ceremony or graduation or whatever it was. And her and I would just have a special time. She'd try to distract me and she'd tell me funny things, and that's just one of the many, many memories I have of Sister Sandra. Like Trisha said, thank you so much for everything you did all those years and the example that you were to all of us. My growing up was just such a special time because of you, because of all the joy and the way that you served the Lord, and what an example that was to me that I take with me.
Sister Sandra, one thing I loved about being in CLA and just about you in general is your profound words of wisdom every morning of devotion, and just your prayers that you would pray for each of us, and just feeling like your love was just coming over us when you prayed that. And you always just had the right thing to say and followed it with a hug that just squeeze the life out of you, but then put 10 times more life back in. And I don't know if you remember this, but one year I decided I would come up with a profound statement at state convention, and it was live in the moment. And I think that that was something that you taught us to do, and that that was exciting to do. And I hope you're doing that today as you celebrate your birthday and celebrate all of the friends and family that have come.
One of the very first memories I have of Sister Sandra, she came to the church we were attending at the time, and she taught a children's choir. And there I sang one of my very first solos. In school, I always ran late. I've been asked to actually sing a song today, so, but in school, I could say so many things about school, but one of my very first memories of you was singing, and you were such an inspiration to me, and I thank you for that.
Why should I feel discouraged? And why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely? and long for heaven and home. When Jesus said, he's my portion, a constant friend is he. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches over me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me. I see, because I'm happy, and I sing because, thank God, I'm free. And his I see, because I'm happy, yes, I see.
One more student here. Actually, I see another one out there, but she's hiding. Miss Jessica and Joe, two more. Come ahead, Esther. Sister Sandra is still teaching, and this is a representative of her today's class.
I want to thank you so much for being such an inspiration in my life, and you always bring out the best in me, if that means I have to repeat every checkup in my algebra paces. And I love you so much.
Approximately 35 years ago, I had a wonderful cousin that lived in Tupelo, Mississippi. Her and her husband had moved up to Tupelo from Fremont, California. And one of the transition times of their vacation, they came to Creve Coeur to visit us. And I was just a young person then, much younger than now. I'm still young. But it was a year that my sister graduated from high school. She had thought she had a desire to go to Bible school, so I said, let's go to Jackson, Mississippi. While we were down in Jackson, Mom had talked to my cousin living in Tupelo, said, you know, Ron and Cheryl is down in Jackson, and maybe they'll come by and see you. So Ramona had given Mom her number. In turn, Mom called us and said, why don't you give Ramona a call and go by and see her since you're not that far away. So we went up there and visited that weekend. And while I was there, she said, you know, I have a really good friend that I think that would make a good wife for you. And I said, okay, that's what a lot of people say. And you know, when you're 25 years old and you're young and handsome and you've got the world, they always have Miss Right for you. And I told Ramona, I said, now, wait a minute. I am not looking for anyone right now. Do you realize I am involved in Sunday school? I'm involved with bus ministry. I'm involved with our Christian school, and I don't have time for a wife. Or, I mean, to go look for a wife. And she said, you've just got to meet my best friend. I said, sure. Well, from that time, for the next 4 years, we had crossed paths, and I made trips down to Jackson and would swing through Tupelo, and I would stop by my cousin's place, and she said, you know what? You just missed Sandra. I said, really? She either went home to Kentucky, or she went to some place, you know, with some of her friends or to meet up with her friends. And that we played tag like this for several years. And then one music conference, I was going to Jackson and swung by Tupelo. And guess what? She and some of her friends from Jackson, from Tupelo, was going to Jackson for music conference. So I got to be her shadow. And later on, I found out that people would still come around and ask her about that guy that followed her around that day on the campus at JCM. And she was a nice person. There was another young lady that my cousin's son, David, was trying to hook me up with. But for some reason, David says, you don't want to marry Sister Sandra. Well, the story behind that was Sister Sandra was David's teacher. And how many of you want your friend, your cousin, to marry your teacher? Well, needless to say, a couple of years, and 1981, at a music conference, it was on a Friday morning during a devotional time, and Brother Lanny Wolf had led us into a worship time, and the presence of the Lord came into that place. And there was about 500-600 people in attendance at this conference, and the Lord spoke to me that this was the one. And I never shared the rest of the story. She knew some of the story, but I was the wait and see kind of person. After music conference, we went back to. I went back to Tupelo and stayed the weekend with my cousin and her husband. Then I made my way on back to Illinois. And then we started writing. And so I was making plans to go down to Tupelo for Thanksgiving. Well, mid part of October, my cousin and her husband left Tupelo, Mississippi, to take a church in St. Augustine, Florida. And so things it kind of changed, and plans failed and fell through, and unbeknownst to me, I was not the most favorite person on Sister Sandra's list, because she changed her plans of not going home for Thanksgiving to stay in Tupelo because I was coming there. Well, needless to say, things kind of went south, really south, from November to January. Then February comes around, because in January I started about asking her to come up here and about the Christian school and about our church and about the ministry and all. And I get this letter from her and said, the only thing that interests me in that school is the principal. And it was capitalized, underline, exclamation point. You know what that means? She was head over heels, not with just anybody, with the... Well, then we go from mid-January, and what follows January is February. And what do you think happens in February? All those hearts and things. And I was being funny because I'm testing the waters. Is not God a year or so before you gave me an assurance that this was the woman? So I went to the Hallmark, got me a beautiful card, and I thought it was going to be such a sentimental card, and I wish she had kept the card because I would have had it posted today. It just moves me. It had the old box camera. Remember those box cameras put out by Kodak? Had a little tab on it, and it said, pull quickly. And she, well, I wasn't there. But evidently, she didn't pull quickly enough, because the film that came out was this beautiful ape. It said, I love you, or be mine. And that really did her in. I'm writing him off. If he's in love with me, this is a strange way to show my love. Well, anyway, I didn't hear from her for several weeks, even though I was faithful about sending her letters and telling her how beautiful the weather up here is in February with the ice and cold. And no, we didn't know anything about frozen. Hello, summer. Well, I knew spring break was coming up in March, so I was preparing her. Take your week, come up to Illinois. I want, you know, and see what we have here. And she sent me a letter and said, yeah, I'll be there. Well, that's my interpretation of her letter, because her letter, I guess she tried to point it out, because I kept my letter from her that said she was coming on spring break. Well, spring break came, and I didn't hear from her, so I called her number and her roommate, Lynn Rybacki, answered the phone. I said, Lynn, is Sandra there? She said, no, she's just left this morning, and she's on her way vacationing. I said, oh, so she's coming to Illinois. Who is this? I said, this is Ron. Remember me? She said, oh, Ron, she is going to St. Augustine, Florida. I said, what? She's going the wrong direction. Okay, this is about 9 o'clock in the morning, and so all day long I'm trying to find my cousin's telephone number. Unbeknownst to me, we've known him as Dave all of his life, and his name wasn't Dave. His name was Philip, David. So guess what? I finally tracked my aunt in California and got his number, and I called down there, and it's about midnight. And she said, nope, we don't know where they are. They should have been here hours ago. So I said, well, I'll call back later. And it was about 2 o'clock, St. Augustine time, and Ramona answers the phone, and I said, well, Sandra there? She said, no, but hang on. I think I just heard an automobile drive up. And about that time, I could hear the commotion at the door, and I hear the voice of Sandra. And Ramona says, "He's on the phone." "Oh, no, he's not." "Yeah, he's on the phone." She said, "Yeah, talk to him." And finally she says in her nice, sweet voice, "Hello?" Because she didn't expect a voice on the other end. "Hello? Yeah, what are you doing down there, Jonah? You're supposed to be up here." And guess what? For a whole week, I ruined her week's vacation because she went to Florida to forget about me. Well, guess what? That was March, and April 1st, we were officially engaged, and then the rest is history. And Sister Sandra, my wife, I love you. 31 years later. Ain't God good? Ain't God good? And I'm so glad that you've been my only wife, and there is no other.
Sandra Lee Harriman Talbot, this is your life. A daughter, a sister, music ministry, deaf ministry, a pastor's wife, a mother, a teacher, a grandmother, all of this and more. And who can find a virtuous woman, for her price is far above rubies? As you look at Sister Talbot's and listen to this, this is the portrait of the virtuous woman. Who can find a virtuous woman, for her price is far above rubies? The heart of her husband doth safely trust in her, so that he shall have no need of spoil. She will do him good and not evil all the days of her life. She seeketh wool and flax, and worketh willingly with her hands. She is like the merchant ships. She brings her food from afar. She rises also while it is yet night, and giveth meat to her household, and a portion to her maidens. She considereth the field, and buyeth it. With the fruit of her hand she planted a vineyard. She girdeth her loins with strength, and strengtheneth her arms. She perceiveth that her merchandise is good. Her candle goeth not out by night. She layeth her hands to spindle, and her hands hold the staff. She stretches out her hand to the poor, yea. She reaches forth her hands to the needy. She maketh herself coverings of tapestry. Her clothing is silk and purple. Her husband is known in the gates when he sitteth among the elders of the land. She maketh fine linen and selleth it, and delivereth girdles unto the merchant. Strength and honor are her clothing, and she shall rejoice in time to come. She openeth her mouth with wisdom, and in her tongue is the law of kindness. She looketh well to the ways of her household, and eateth not the bread of idleness. Her children arise up and call her blessed, her husband also, and he praiseth her. Many daughters have done virtuously, but thou excellest them all. Favor is deceitful, and beauty is vain, but a woman that feareth the Lord, she shall be praised. Give her of the fruit of her hands, and let her own works praise her in the gates. Proverbs 31:10, the portrait of a virtuous woman.
Sister Sandra, we present to you, this is your life. to stand here and look pretty. Yes, this is the conclusion of this part, the segment, and then we'll ask you to join us downstairs for the fellowship.